On March 7th, on the eve of International Women's Day, Joy of Resistance is honored to present a screening of the newly released and widely acclaimed film, The Rape of Recy Taylor. In 1944, Recy Taylor, a black Alabama sharecropper, was kidnapped while leaving church and gang-raped by six white men. Such assaults of African-American women were common in the Jim Crow South. Threatened that she would be killed if she told, she spoke out anyway, and the local NAACP sent their best organizer to help her. Her name was Rosa Parks. The campaign that followed became a nationwide protest and helped to spark the civil rights movement. Now a film has been made of this extraordinary story, and you can see it on March 7th at the Brooklyn Commons and stay for the panel afterward. This is a benefit for WBAI. For more information, go to WBAI.org.
There was a song came on the radio, a guitar instrumental, and it changed everything.
Link Ray, it's rock and roll.
Rumble. Yeah, that's the one.
Rumble.
Hey, Rumble.
Rumble had the power to help me say, I'm going to be a musician.
And then I found out that he was an Indian.
Music that we know here in the United States is fully supported by input from Native and Indigenous people.
Say hello, this is John Cain from Let's Talk. I will be hosting an encore screening of Rumble, the Indians who rocked the world, Wednesday, February 28th at 7 p.m. at the Brooklyn Commons, 388 Atlantic Avenue in Brooklyn, New York. Come join us.
Only two things scare me, and one is nuclear war.
What's the other?
Excuse me?
What's the other thing that scares you?
Hi, this is Jamie.
Hi, this is Sarah from Brand Van 3000, and you're listening to
WBAI 99.5 FM.
New York?
New York.
Did you know that when you apply for a job, your credit history may affect your chances of getting hired? And if you already have a job, your credit history can still be used against you. That's because a growing number of employers use credit reports to make hiring and firing decisions. This practice can have a discriminatory impact on people and communities of color and unfairly block many qualified people from employment. Help end this practice by speaking up. If you or someone you know has been turned down for a job or even fired from a job because of credit checks by an employer, please call NIDAS Financial Justice Hotline at 212-925-4929. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back. give another round to the Resistance Revival Chorus. That was magnificent. So now, we are going to have a short talk with abena-koomson-davis.
And that is also part of the heart and soul to make sure that we are uplifting music that we're standing literally on the shoulders of, but also to give a platform in particular to women, female musicians, to create their own music of resistance.
And you guys are becoming very popular now. I see you got such a schedule for the next several weeks. So that means you are resonating with a lot of people, and they do feel that what you're doing is important, correct?
Yeah. And it also, you know, it makes what we're doing, it comes at a cost, right? And
okay.
So we also have to figure out what's the way to be able to meet that need of that desire, but also inspire people to create resistance revivals and create joy and create music in their communities.
Mm-hmm. And during these, you know, interesting times, yeah, I prefer to say interesting.
Yes. Interesting.
Okay. You guys have helped support other movements, not just the Women's March,
yes.
But then you all saw that performance.
kind of like to think of us as linking in arms, all
That's
of us
good.
Together.
That's fine.
Right? So we're forward stronger and with regards to, we performed at part of the resistance.
say time. They say time, but I wanna know y'all.
How much time will this really take?
Oh, Lord.
Before the world is in a better place?
Oh, somebody tell me. Well, well, well. Now, the day when time brings on that blessed change.
NYC, where we cover art. And we are continuing with our broadcast. Tonight we just had the Resistance Revival Chorus joining us, and we would like to thank them for coming out to honor both Black History Month and Women's History Month. And so now, in our talk portion of the show, we have with us, I'm very excited, Bridgit Antoinette Evans, who is the Executive Director of the Pop Culture Collaborative, and we have Tanya Selvaratnam, I'm close, I know, it's tough, who is one of the co-founders of the Federation. And I was very impressed with both of these organizations. For Tanya, I met one of her other co-founders, Laurie Anderson, and she was on our show last fall. We had a great time talking about, you know, her career, her late husband, what she was doing at Times Square. But now she, Tanya, and Laura, who is the co-founder of the Sundance Film Festival.
Sundance Production,
have started an arts activist group. And then with Bridgit, she and others have formed this collaborative that's going to add real meaning to the entertainment industry. You're going to diversify that entertainment industry with some real muscle, some money.
That is the hope, yeah.
Yes, and so therefore I asked them both for this sort of roundtable to talk about what they foresee in the future, you know, the dynamics in this country when it comes to entertainment and when it comes to art. So let me start with Tanya. So Tanya, she has a very impressive background. She's a writer, actor, activist, and an Emmy-nominated and Webby-winning producer, with more than 20 years of experience working in the areas of arts and justice. So tell us, how did this all begin with you and your co-founders?
Well, the Federation, the idea, the spark came from Laurie Anderson.
Okay.
She had recently come back from Berlin, where she was doing a residency, and was worried about what she perceived as the growing refugee crisis there and the increasing nationalism. Mm-hmm. And it was back in March that we got together for dinner, and it was before the harmful tactics of the current administration, like the travel ban, had taken effect. But we knew that there was there were these harmful tactics to come. And
yes.
So Laurie said, what can we do about it? And we said, well, why don't we gather people together and talk about it and
okay.
see what happens?
Okay.
And I actually met with Bridgit right before that first meeting.
Yeah.
So it's kind of extraordinary that here we are mm-hmm. almost a year
yeah.
later.
And I actually attended that first meeting.
Yes.
Via Skype. I was one of the few on Skype for that really powerful gathering.
Now, I didn't know that the two of you knew each other beforehand when I planned all of this. So this is serendipity.
Well, yeah. Not only that, but the Resistance Revival Chorus performed at our public launch.
Oh, look at this!
On October 11th.
Hey!
So, Savona, you are a shaman.
I didn't, but I guess the energy was there.
Yes.
I felt it. And, you know, like-minded spirits do come together. So now.
Especially now.
Yes. And we need it. And with Bridgit, your group, very fascinating how you're trying to impact the industry. Tell us how that all began.
You know, what we have in this country is a long, long, incredibly rich history of artists and activists working together to drive movements, very much like the chorus. And that has often made its way into the pop culture stories that we hear or that we experience through all of television, film, music, et cetera. Those experiences have often, in recent years, been siloed, single stories. A film comes out that creates a conversation, but there's no way to really allow it to gather momentum and become a real catalyst for change, although Black Panther is certainly
yes.
making a very new example.
Yes.
The collaborative, the Pop Culture Collaborative, was founded just a year ago and created by a group of foundations in the social justice sector in order to take all of that momentum, all of these rich stories that were taking place across all these mediums, and create a level of deep collaboration among them. So we catalyze partnerships between social justice movements and the entertainment industry in order to profoundly and fundamentally change the stories that we tell mm-hmm. about people of color, immigrants, refugees, and Muslims in this country, and to build the infrastructure and the safer workplaces and the pipelines that are needed to ensure that storytellers of color have what they need to lead in the creation of these stories.
Wow. You know, it's interesting that sometimes out of chaos, art, good art, can be developed. And it seems like, Tanya, with your group and with Bridgit's group, it looks like this time of chaos is actually bringing forth a lot of good. Would you say that? And I mean, because I'm talking about the initiative you did for the anniversary of the inauguration of Donald Trump, and you had events on the steps of the New York Public Library. I mean, that was awesome.
Yeah.
Tell us.
Well, I am constantly reminding myself of a quote from James Baldwin that really guides me. The precise role of the artist is to make the world a more human dwelling place. And that to me is kind of the fundamental inspiration for the Federation, is that when there are threats to vulnerable communities, the artists have to rally and support them. So we have this laser focus to create programming by and for
yes.
artists from vulnerable communities, and also to keep cultural borders open.
Yes.
And to show how art unites us.
Yes.
I hesitate to call ourselves a resistance group.
Mm-hmm.
We're often lumped together with that description, because I think if you're always resisting and fighting back, you also need to remember to unite and build up.
Yes. And I try to remind people that sometimes it's not always about tearing things down, but it's about what you build as well.
Yeah, and it's not that, you know, it's not that art itself mm-hmm. is going to change the world, but it can inspire people to change the world, and it can inspire them to think in ways that are new.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we hope to do with the Federation. The Federation itself is it's this kind of conglomeration of many different organizations. We don't really have any ownership of the group, but it's more kind of providing that camaraderie and solidarity mm-hmm. to keep us doing the right thing. So it's organizations like Pan America, the Public Theater, it's social media platforms like Spotify and Tumblr. It's amazing how just bringing these people together that otherwise would not meet really is
right.
like a catalyst for new initiatives and new collaborations.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that happened on the steps of the New York Public Library, that was hosted by Pen America and about a dozen different literary organizations. And what I loved about it was how representative it was. It was just like a big smile on everybody's faces, because we had artists from the different vulnerable communities. It was Andre Assaman, it was Sapphire, it was Justin Vivian Bond, you know, it was Jennifer Bartlett. Ann Carson, Ann Waldman, just, you know, reading traditional texts of resistance.
Yes.
So by Joy Harjo, by David Wojnarowicz, by Kathy Lynn Che, you know, by Howard Zinn. And just hearing those words anew and how resonant they are today. And, you know, I feel like that's our role right now.
And it's also reintroducing people who have been so profound in our culture, our American culture, for such a long time, and allowing younger people to hear these names, to hear these words, and realize that we've been fighting for a very, very long time. It crosses generations. It's just not now. It's been going on for a long time.
The struggle continues, but I am very optimistic.
Okay.
I think these are terrifying times, but they're also extraordinary, exciting times.
Mm.
And I mean, you mentioned young people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what really gives me hope. Just watching what the young people are doing, especially right now with what happened in Parkland and how they're really rallying.
That was
and
amazing.
Leading us.
Yeah, that was amazing how quickly that was organized and how they scared a lot of people in Washington to pay attention and say, enough. is enough. And so, Bridgit, bringing you back in, you're bringing some teeth to this movement, because it's not about activism. It's also about money. Mm-hmm. And this country, you know, responds to money. And how are you going to put some of that money behind breaking down some walls? What are some of your initiatives that you're planning?
Yeah, you know, I'm really struck by your original question around the role that art and artists play in times like these. And, you know, there are just so many really very toxic and harmful narratives all swirling around us. It's a profoundly upsetting kind of chaotic space to be living in. But what we found is that there's just a no shortage of artists and activists who want to come together to actually take on those narratives and really transform them. So what we see is our role is to support those collaborations in a whole range of ways. You mentioned that we are a fund, technically. Mm-hmm. So with the foresight and vision of our founding partners, which are, as I mentioned, a range of foundations, we have a multi-million dollar fund that is dedicated to providing grants to people in the entertainment industry, people in the social justice sector, and a whole other range of industries who are focused on transforming the narratives of our culture through pop culture. So we do grants. We also convene artists and activists all over the country to think together, learn together, and conspire and build new collaborative projects. We just actually announced our latest round of grants, for instance. One of them that we're really excited about because it's focused on reimagining the pipelines through which storytellers of color are able to bring their stories to mass audiences is a grant that we made to Issa Rae and Denise Davis of Color Creative. Color Creative, which is a kind of amazing incubator space for emerging storytellers of color. We also made a grant to a new studio called Unleashing Giants.
Wow, that's an interesting name.
Isn't that an amazing name?
Wow.
Yeah.
I like that.
Emil Pinnock and Chike, who are working on a new pilot for television.
Okay.
And they actually are one of the early pioneers in the indie television movement, which is offering particularly storytellers of color the opportunity own their stories and to have real creative license to control how their stories move their way into the world. So Up North is focused on exploring issues of mass incarceration, and they have built a television writers' room that includes television writers from shows that you've heard of and formerly incarcerated men and women who are activists or people who are living with their experience and trauma who are sitting down as equal partners at the writers' room table to create a television show.
Now, that's groundbreaking.
Yeah, I think it is. I do actually think it is, and that is where we've sort of found our space is really in a more experimental context. We're not interested solely or even mostly in diversity and inclusion programs as they exist today and supporting those efforts. We're really interested in exploring how to get more power in the hands of storytellers to be able to design and lead in the process of making stories in television, in film, in music, with the resources that the industry really has to offer them.
And then this all goes back full circle to the resistance choir. They're saying that they are trying to bring joy to the resistance. And I feel that in the United States, we're not concerned with the happiness of our citizens, which we should be paying attention to. In other countries, they actually care about each other. And I think what you guys are trying to do, you're trying to encourage all of us to, you know, look out for each other, care about each other. Do you feel that that is one of your missions for your group?
Absolutely. It's to be engaged and be together. Because together, we can make change. Mm-hmm. And also to recognize how uplifting and joyful, as the Resistance Revival Chorus demonstrates, art can be. Mm-hmm. And with the Federation, We are about giving people opportunities to make art, experience art, and support art, whatever that might mean for them. And also, it's very important to give people the tools to empower them to do things in their own way and let them take the ball and run with it. So another thing that we do is we create resources. So we have legal resources on our website. We have a reading list that the Brooklyn Public Library curated. We have an Art Action Day sing-along list that Laurie Anderson curated. So just providing people with these tools that they can adapt and make their own is very important. Because I do believe that culture can transform consciousness, which is why it's so exciting what the Pop Culture Collaborative is doing, because it's like finally matching money with these ideas and initiatives, because that's the gap.
That's one of the problems in the arts.
Because it's been so much about these systems that we have built that enslave us, and if we can't tear them down, then we need to infiltrate them.
And with that, because I just have to say this, you know, we're hoping that our listeners will take a moment to, you know, support WBAI right now. WBAI is a listener-supported station, and we rely on the support of listeners to give contributions. And we're asking, this is what we're here for, to offer you enlightened programming, you know, emotionally filled moments where you will understand why, you know, life is important, why we should pay attention to each other. So I am asking our listeners, if you can, whatever you can, become a WBAI buddy, give a one-time contribution if you can. But we want to stay on the air to continue to bring women like Bridgit, women like Tanya, and the Resistance Revival Chorus here to the studio in the cafe so that you can feel inspired, enlightened, and you'll share that with us. I do need to say that because a lot of people don't realize how important listenership-based radio is. And it is important, and many are struggling across the country, but we're here in New York City and the number one market in the country, and we're trying to share our wisdom and understanding with others. So I just want to say before we wrap up, you know, Bridgit, besides that incarceration program, which I'm impressed with, that's really impressive, what other programs is your collaborative thinking about doing?
Well, we've supported over 25 organizations and artist-driven projects thus far, and we're not even a year old, so we're moving as quickly as we can to move resources into the field. We are really excited by some of the social justice organizations that are working in the entertainment industry that we're supporting and have partnered with, including Color of Change, who recently released a new report called Race in the Writer's Room, which is a fantastic analysis of both the reality of how race and race representation exists in the stories, but not only that, in the storytellers, in the people who sit in writers' rooms every day creating all of these characters and storylines. The reality is disturbing, quite frankly. It's still a predominantly white and male led storytelling workplace. But one of the things that they really did to overcome that hurdle was to analyze what happened when people of color, and particularly black people, are hired as showrunners on television shows.
But look at film. Look at the Black Panther. And next week, we're going to be talking about the Black Panther. Look how that has become a phenomenon. My God, I wanted to dance after I saw the film.
Isn't it? Yeah.
I wanted to dance. It was just so wonderful. But that's because Disney and Marvel took the time and the effort to hire staff that represented a rainbow of people. And now they're going to triple their investment just because they decided to make that risk. So do you see that there's going to be a big change soon?
Yeah, and I think it's really great to point out that it's not just that they hired black people to populate this world on screen, but we need to look at what happens when you give resources to a storyteller of color with genius and creativity and a social justice heart.
Yes.
to tell a story in the mainstream that reaches literally, I don't know how many millions of people have seen this movie. Yeah. We need to actually tell the story of the full trajectory. It's not just about what ends up on the screen. It's about investing in storytellers and giving them the full range of resources that they need to put their genius before mass audiences. And that's something that the collaborative is working very, very steadily to do, is move those resources into the hands of storytellers of color, so that we have many Black Panthers or maybe smaller
Wonder
movies,
Women.
But equally profoundly
yes.
culturally disruptive and joyful
yes.
as Black Panther.
So, Tanya, I'm going to wrap up with you. Is the Federation planning anything real soon?
Yes. We are getting ready to team up with Four Freedoms, which is one of our participants, to launch a 50-state initiative. This fall, it was an idea that I spoke about at that very first gathering, that the long-term dream, if we keep going, would be to do a 50-state list.